always says that you've got to replace what's going inside of him, and you can't get back in the same environment. If you're an alcoholic, you can't hang out at a bar. I'm just telling you. Right? Doesn't that make sense? Yeah. But that's what people do. If you're hanging around people that are doing drugs and you stop doing them, guess what? It ain't going to be long. When Jesus, immediately the boy's father exclaimed, "I do believe, help me overcome my unbelief. Help me with my unbelief." Would you repeat that after me? Help me with my unbelief. One more time. Help me with my unbelief. There it is. There's where we struggle. There's where some of the problem is. We want to increase our faith, but sometimes it's not our faith that's the problem. It's our unbelief. We don't believe that it can happen. I'm too old. I'm too set in my ways. You replace the I with Jesus can and see what happens. Because I can't do anything. I just whined. I just complained. I is just the center of the universe. Let me tell you something. There's only one person who is the center of the universe, and it's Jesus Christ. For the Word of God says that nothing was made without him, and without him nothing was made. He sits in the center of the universe. And your doubt, see, that's the problem. Our unbelief. It's not that we don't think he can do it. It's that we don't believe and trust that he can do it. And I don't care how silly it may seem. Men and husbands and wives fight more over where they're going to eat than any other topic. Did you know that? Where do you want to eat? I don't care. I'll eat wherever you want to do. Well, where do you want to eat? Well, I don't know. Well, how about, this is me. Sandy'll say, "Well, how about Italian?" "No, no, I don't want Italian." And she says, she goes, "What about Mexican?" I'm like, "No, no, you know, kind of like Crystal, but we don't have a Crystal around here." And she'll say, "We're going home." And then I say, "Well, Italian didn't sound bad." Because I know what's coming. That we argue about. Hey, I got a solution. Here's how you solve that problem. Jesus, where do you want us to eat tonight? Let the Holy Spirit tell you. Because he may have a setup there that you don't know about. There may be somebody there that's appointed to meet somebody who knows Jesus Christ, and you be the somebody. And if you don't go there, why? And you see, I know that works because it happens to us all the time. But we don't involve God in our selections of where we're going to eat. And see, that's a little big thing. You think God really cares where I eat? Amen. And let me prove it to you. When Jesus is talking about not worrying, he says in that discussion, "God knows every hair on your head." Or in some cases, the lack thereof. If he knows the hairs on your head, do you think he cares where you eat? Yes, he does. Stop our unbelief. Stop telling each other God don't care about that. Because he does care. Because he's got a set up there and he wants it. See, you're not here by accident this morning. Say, "Oh, come on, let's go to church." I mean, you may have came with an unbelief faith, but right now God's speaking to you. He's got something he wants you to do, and he wants you to have the conviction and the courage to go do it. Because you trust. So this father says, help my unbelief. Notice it's the father that says, help my unbelief, not the disciples. Amen. He's fixing to take care of that. When Jesus saw the crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the impure spirit. You deaf and mute spirit, he said, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. Did you catch the second part of that statement?
Yeah.
Come out of him and don't ever go back.
Amen.
Man, that's authority there.
Amen.
That's authority. Sometimes I wish I could do that with our kids. Go home and don't ever come back. No, I'm kidding. You can send the grandkids. Here. The grandkids are good. You do not so much. I'm only kidding. They're always there. What power in his name? What power in his message? You leave, you don't ever come back. I'm testimony to that. Those words were spoken over me. The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, he's dead. Get it? Get that? Jesus killed him. There's your unbelief. There's your lack of trust. And I'm telling you, it happens like this because some of you have said, I've said, and some of you have said, why did God let this happen to me? How many of us have gone through something and we blame God for it? You know? And then later on we had to repent. Because you see, if that didn't happen, this couldn't happen. If that didn't happen, you wouldn't appreciate this that's fixing to come at you. See, God set you up for something greater. And at the moment, you can't think about that. At the moment, you can't process that. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet and stood up. And after Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, why couldn't we drive it out? This kind can come out only by prayer. The whole statement, if you read the whole statement, a word is omitted in this translation, but what it basically says, by prayer and fasting. A show of hands, how many have fasted before longer than 3 days? There's value in fasting. This is about prayer and fasting. This demon can't be dealt with. So there are some powers in the universe that are coming in on you. There's some powers that are coming in on your life that can only be dealt with by fasting and prayer. You may have had a situation that's been going on year after year after year after year, and you've never been able to break free from it. It's because you haven't prayed and fasted enough. I'm not saying you haven't prayed enough, but he says pray and fast, and you have got to surrender to him and trust that he can do it. We have a terrific fasting plan if you'd like to know about it. Sandy and I'd be glad to share the information with you. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to wrap this up right here. They couldn't see what he could see. In where they are, they didn't have the foresight to see what Jesus could see. Jesus knew. Can we agree Jesus knew he was going to heal this boy? Amen? That's why he didn't get all upset when he was rolling around on the ground. He wasn't being unkind. He's like, I'm going to take care of that. But I got to teach you something here. Lazarus' tomb. He's dead. He's nice, he's sleeping. I'm fixing to wake him up. Jesus knew the day that he heard that he was sick, that he was going to die, he knew he was going to be dead. He knew he was going to go take care of it. But for them, he had to increase their faith so they would move from the place of unbelief to total trust in him. That's where we are this morning. He's just asking us to trust him no matter what our circumstances are, no matter where we find ourselves. I'm so thankful for the people that were praying over me. I'm so thankful for my wife not letting go of me. I'm so thankful that I laid there for 8 days and it looked worse and worse and worse. And yet she didn't stop coming. She didn't stop praying. She didn't stop contacting people to pray. Now, maybe God knew on the very first day, Mary's got to go through this, but I'm going to take care of it. I mean, I guess he already knew that. So he was increasing our faith. He was increasing our every day to pray, every day to pray. And you prayed, and you prayed. And people all over the world were praying for me. And God showed up one day and said, that's enough. Let's get him up. And see, people lose jobs, and people go through divorces, and people lose loved ones, and we struggle in the midst of all that we go through. And Jesus is saying to us, if we will just trust him. He says to us, if you can. What do you mean? If you can, of course I can. I can lift you up. But sometimes it takes prayer and fasting. Total trust in him and what he can do. And what he's capable of doing. I know we are bombarded with negative information every day, all day long. It's just negative, 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 negative. That's, you know, and I'm telling you what, if it wasn't coming here and being lifted up in praise and worship, if it wasn't coming here and hearing people tell me stories of faith, and man, I just don't know. Here's the last thing that I want to share with you that is so key in our growing in him and our moving forward in him. This is the key that unlocks the door. You need to understand everything that has ever happened to you. Everything that has ever happened to you. Everything that is going to happen to you. Jesus is already taking care of it. You see, when he went to the cross, he took care of everything. See, we just like, well, he took care of my sins, but he doesn't care about it. When he took care of your sins, he restored you. He gave you back the dignity that guilt and shame had robbed from you. He not only saved you, but he restored you. Doesn't mean you're not going to sin. What he does mean is that sin's already been taken care of. You don't get saved and then create another sin and God goes, oh well, it's all right. You were good for 8 hours. Doesn't work that way. 1 John says, these things are written that you might know you have eternal life. To whom he says doesn't sin, to him he is a liar, and the truth is not in him. We acknowledge the fact that we are sinners. That's not a license to go out and sin. That's an understanding that the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all unrighteousness. And that's a continual action. It's always doing it. It never stops doing it. Because I promise you, you sin and don't know it. See, people like, if we confess our sins, yeah, you got to confess your sins. But I promise you, you do some things that you don't even know you did them. And here's one that always trips me up. This is what always trips me up. The Word of God says this: to him that knoweth to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. For him who knows to do good and doesn't do it, to him it is sin. Man, I found a wallet on the ground and I had $100 in it, and I just took the $100 because there's nobody going to know. That wasn't your $100. That belonged to somebody. You just sinned. If this Holy Spirit speaks to you and says, hey, you need to call so-and-so. And how that happens is you just, through the day, you're, you know, watching TV and somebody just pops in your brain. And you go to, I'll do that later. And then later comes and then you don't do it. Man, if somebody comes to your mind, stop what you do and call them. It ain't going to take a lot out of your life. Because you never know what you're doing to help somebody. Send them a text. Send them an email. You're on the phone all day long anyway. Might as well use it for some good. Just say, hey, thinking about you, love you, man. Boom. Send it. You might catch somebody in the middle of the worst moment of their day, and they look down at that and go, I was in the midst of a day, and I had the Midas touch that day. You know, everything I touched turned to mufflers. You know, I was in a good pity place. I was really feeling sorry for myself. You know, you ever been there? No, not y'all. But anyway, I was. Nobody loves me, everybody hates me. Guess I'll go eat worms. I was at that place. And I got a text from one of our family members here. And he said, I just want to let you know that I love you. Have a great day, Pastor. And being a good Christian, I said, well, he's the only one that ever sins me. See, that's what we do. Ain't that where we go? Ain't that where we go? We go right there. We go, ain't nobody else. It meant a lot to me. It lifted me up. So to him that knoweth to do good and doesn't do it, to him to sin. Let's focus on our unbelief and change that. And then when we just, like, you know, when God says jump, we say, I believe you can. Let that be your prayer this morning as we go into time of decision. Let that be in your head this morning. Help me with my unbelief. Yes, Watson.
Both back in the area where there are rows of
Someone was.
And I, when I prayed for her, I said, told her the story about I lost you in the crowd, but there you are. So I decided to come and find you. And she looked at me and she said, thank you so much for the prayer. But more than anything, thank you for not giving up on me. For finding me again. And we both stood there with tears in our eyes. And there were other people in line and they got very quiet and they just listened. And I told her, I said, I will put a prayer request in at the church for you.
Amen.
And I will pray for you and that everything goes well. And it's breast cancer that she's fighting. And she's about 45 years old, maybe 50. And she, but when she turned to me and she said, thank you for not giving up on fighting.
Right.
That's touched my heart. So I walked out to the car and sat there and cried for a while because that really touched me.
Yes.
You know, so we just have to make contact with people. And she was so grateful that someone was praying for her.
Amen. Amen. Thanks for being faithful. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, all you have to do is ask him in. That's it. Just ask him to come in your life. There's no secret formula. There's no right words. It's just surrender to him. Say, thank you for going to the cross for me. I will accept you as my Lord and Savior. That's it. That's all you have to do. He'll come and set up shop. And he'll bring the Holy Spirit with you. And you can be transformed. If you've been struggling with unbelief, ask him to help your unbelief, that you might be strengthened. If you need somebody to pray with you, we'll be right down here. You can come right now, and we'll pray with you as we stand together to sing.